Where is MOC? Manisha?
Yeah.
Anjali? Are you there?
Yes,
ma'am. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
A very good evening to one and all. I'm sure all of us had an amazing day today. On behalf of NOGS Team 2021, myself, Dr. Anjali Dhote, and my colleague, Dr. Manisha Sahu, welcome you to today's CME.
Hi.
Today we are back with the second module of our Safe Motherhood CME on preterm labor. Preterm labor resulting into preterm birth is the single largest cause of neonatal mortality and morbidity. And the babies who survive have high rates of disabilities, including neurodevelopmental disabilities. With increase in the number of ART conceptions, increased maternal age and other contributing factors, the incidence of preterm labor is also on the rise. Management of preterm labor cannot be emphasized more. This CME on preterm labor. Chignish, can you mute? There's a lot of disturbance.
Yes, Chignish. Jignesh himself is talking. Let me see.
इसका बहुत वैल्यू है इसका जो है ना आपका
नहीं बजाने का करने का कुछ नहीं मुंह बजाने
नाउ
आई थिंक इट्स बेटर नाउ
यू अनम्यूट योरसेल्फ
सॉरी फॉर द टेक्निकल ग्लिच. We are extremely delighted to have with us today Dr. Anita Singh Ma'am, Vice President FOCSI, as our chief guest. I assure you all a wonderful academic feast with established speakers and reputed chairpersons of the day. We have with us as our chairpersons Dr. Sutapa Rao Ma'am, Dr. Shobha Gandhi Ma'am, Dr. Sadhana Deshmukh Ma'am, and Dr. Anjali Bhandarkar Ma'am. Today's CME has been granted one ICOG credit point. And those who wish to avail it are requested to kindly send in your details on the following numbers. MacLeod's Pharma has been very supportive. We have received the academic grant for today's CME from them. I thank.
Anjali, I'm not able to hear anything. Anju?
Yeah, I'm unmuted, ma'am.
Is she audible or am I?
Am I audible? Ma'am.
She's audible.
She's audible.
Am I audible now?
Yeah, you are perfectly audible.
मला काहीच आवाज येत
नाहीये. तेरे अलका तेरे लेवल पे प्रॉब्लम आहे.
हां. बाकीला ऐकू येतं सगळ्यांना.
मी लीव करून पुन्हा रीजॉइन.
हां हां. यस यस यस. यू लीव द मीटिंग एंड देन रीजॉइन.
Jignesh, can we have the slides?
Anjali ma'am, till the meanwhile, could you just, if you're the host, could you just mute all so
yeah,
that
sure.
There won't be any disturbance.
Hello.
I'll come back. Yeah, you are, ma'am.
Yeah, and can you hear me? Yes, yes. Now I am able to hear you.
Okay, I'll go ahead then.
Okay.
So today's CME has been granted one ICOG credit point. To avail it, please forward your name in full with your MMC registration number on the following numbers. All good things start with a prayer. So does our CME. It starts with our NOGS prayer. Jignesh, the prayer, please. May we all be content and satisfied. May ethics and morality be an integral part of our practice. May we show a mark of respect and reverence towards fellow colleagues, that nobody indulges in moral crimes like medical jousting or female feticide. May we pay enough attention to our own emotional and physical well-being. May patience and compassion be the fundamentals of our treatment and pathy. let us all strive hard for the well-being of the mother. For a healthy mother equals a healthy nation. Together we will, together we can. Long live NOJS. May I now invite our beloved president, Dr. Alka Mukherjee ma'am, for a welcome address.
Thank you, Anjali. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Friends, a smile is the best tool to welcome even strangers. So with a big and huge smile, I welcome you all for today's CME on Preterm Labour. It's our third CME in order and second CME on Safe Motherhood. I feel all our NOJS members, they remember this year's theme, that is Safe Mom, Safe Talk. Some people you always remember as they create unique impression in your heart. And same holds true for our guest today with a unique persona, Dr. Anita Singh Madam. She's a Vice President of POPSI. Welcome, ma'am, to our NOJS family. As a senior person, POPSI is here. Let me inform her and refresh you all with the basic plans of NOJS this year. Number one, our 365 days tips on entire OBGY subjects are released daily at 9 a.m., wherein we are receiving zest of a particular topic in the form of a tip, which is practical and useful. Second project is Ganganga project of recorded presentations. Is of course a unique feature of Saturdays, wherein we have the recorded presentations of the Chupe Rustams. The third project is Rural Connect, is all about our social responsibility for the women in and around Nagpur, wherein we are training the PSC medical officers. It's an international project. The fourth important project of our tenure, we are securing our future by integrated PG teaching program of 8 medical colleges of Vidarbha. Wednesdays are known for webcams, the online CMEs. As of today, they are known for their speakers and the content. The forthcoming big events are fellowship event, that is NOJS popcorn show on 1st of May. Don't forget to log in. Then there is CME on 5th May with Dr. P.K. Devi Oration on anemia. One of the biggest events, that is installation ceremony of our tenure, is on 16th May, Sunday. 22nd May is clinical activity and 6th June is PCOS conference, that is PERCON. So stay tuned with all of us. Today's CME is a complete power pack knowledge at its best kind of CME. I welcome Dr. Anita, Dr. Neema, Dr. Raju, Dr. Amog, and Dr. Ashish. I welcome all the respected chairpersons and all of you. Friends, extend your arms in to welcome the future. The best is yet to come. Enjoy the CME. Stay safe. Thank you so much. Back to MOC. Anju, please unmute yourself.
थैंक यू डॉक्टर अंजलि
डॉक्टर मनीषा
हेलो मिस्टर जिग्नेश कैन आई हैव द पीपीटी शेयरिंग प्लीज Thank you, Alka ma'am. Hello, everyone, and a very warm good evening to all respected seniors, colleagues, and dear friends. It is my great honor and privilege to welcome our chief guest, Dr. Anita Singh ma'am. Dr. Anita Singh ma'am is the ex-professor, Patna Medical College. She has been the past president, Patna Obstetric and Gynec Society, the vice president of FOCSI 2020, She is the chairperson, she had been the chairperson Endocrinology Committee, FOCSI, 2014 and 2016. Member Governing Council, ICOG, 2015 to 2020. And a chief consultant, JP Hospital and Jan Chikitsa Hospital, Patna. I welcome you, ma'am. Hello.
Thank you, Manisha. Thank you, Manisha, for the introduction. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Dear Dr. Alka Mukherjee, the President, Nagpur Obstetrics Gynae Society, Ashish Kurde, the Secretary of such a prestigious society, and my dear esteemed speakers for today's CME, Dr. Anita Joseph, Neelam Acharya, Raju Girardi, Amok Chimote, and Ashish Kumble. I know they are all very experienced clinicians as well as academicians, and they are going to do justice with the topics that have been allotted to them or they have chosen. And along with them, we have very knowledgeable and experienced chairpersons like Dr. Sutapa Roy, Sadhana Deshmukh, Shobha Gandhi, and Anjali Bhandarkar. And our coordinator, master of ceremony today, Anjali and Manisha. And my dear esteemed audience for today's CME. And I also want to thank the organizers, especially Alka and the secretary Ashish, for inviting me for this prestigious CME on preterm labor as a chief guest. I was listening to Alka's talk and the programs of Nagpur Obstetrics Gynae Society. How tremendous amount of work you people are doing and will be doing in the future, and Nagpur Society has done in the past, as Lakshmi Srikhande being one of the very important and experienced members of your society. I often keep meeting her, and I know how well she participates in all the activities of FOCSI also. She's a very good friend of mine. And I'm thankful to Matthew Pharma, who has been the academic partner of this CME. Coming to the topic, that is preterm labor, it's a great burden to the society because our numbers in India are large. We have a huge population. In all the field, most of the times we talk.
Madam, please unmute yourself.
Okay, just now I got unmuted. The tremendous amount of people that we have every year in our country is something remarkable. And we do have around, according to the last census, 35,19,000 preterm deliveries every year. Mm-hmm. And around 34% of neonatal deaths, forget about morbidity, the deaths occur because of preterm labor and its complications. So I can understand why you have chosen this topic to be discussed in detail today. And the topics are very well selected amongst it, right from prediction to prevention and postponement of labor by tocolytics, as well as the important role of corticosteroids are going to be discussed. And along with that, I think there is going to be a very fruitful discussion on emergency surcharge, which is still quite controversial. And with this, I know we all are going to be back with some addition to our knowledge that we do have at the moment, and that we will pass on for the benefit of our patients in the future. And in the end, I will quote Socrates saying that it is better to change an opinion than to persist in a wrong one. So if somebody who has not yet changed the opinion regarding tocolytics, corticosteroids, emergency surplus, I think after listening to the fruitful discussion of today's CME, will be in a position to get it changed for the betterment of our patients. Thank you very much and wishing all the best for today's CME.
Thank you, madam. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am, for your words. Thank you, ma'am, for your pearls of wisdom words. Before we go on to the first session, I would like to come up with the NOGS vision and mission. Mr. Jignesh, please do the PPT sharing. NOGS vision, the Nagpur Obstetrical and Gynecological Society have a vision that women of Nagpur achieve the highest possible standards of physical, mental, reproductive, and sexual health throughout their lives. The NOGS mission, NOGS supports and protects the interest of obstetricians and gynecologists in Nagpur. NOGS considers eradication of anemia, safe abortions, school health, cancer awareness, reduction of maternal mortality as its main mission. NOGS also encourages dissemination of knowledge and education, as well as research in the field of obstetrics and gynecology in Nagpur, by using scientific evidence and following the highest ethical standards through its membership of committed professionals. NOGS discourages the practice of sex determination and sex-selected abortions and violence against women and children. NOGS exhibits zero tolerance for violence against doctors and medical jousting. With this, we further proceed to our scientific sessions. For the further proceedings, today CME has been granted one ICOG point, and to avail this ICOG credit point, you can contact these numbers. The academic support by Macleod's Pharmaceuticals Osteva has been grateful enough for this educational grant. Thank you. And I hand over further proceedings to Dr. Anjali. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Manisha ma'am. Thank you. Here we begin with our session one. I invite our chairpersons for this session. I invite Dr. Sutapai Roy ma'am and Dr. Sadhana Deshmukh ma'am. Madam Roy has been gold medalist in her post-graduation and is ex-senior lecturer GMC Nagpur. She has been faculty at various local, state and national conferences. And let me tell you, travelogue writing is her hobby. She is presently director and consultant at Roy Nursing Home. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you.
We also have Dr. Sadhana Deshmukh ma'am with us today. She is a senior practicing obstetrician and gynecologist at Nagpur with her practice of more than 33 years. She is the director of Renuka Hospital, Nagpur. I welcome you, ma'am, and I hand over the proceedings to both of you, ma'am.
Good afternoon, everyone. The topic for today's CME is preterm labor. Forewarned is forearmed, and our first speaker, Dr. Anita Joseph, will be speaking on prediction of PTL. A short introduction of our speaker, Dr. Anita Joseph has done her MBBS and MD from JIPMER. She has done her DNB in 2008. She has got her fellowship in fetomaternal medicine from Idappal in 2012. At present, she is working as consultant in fetal medicine from fetal medicine in Matha Hospital, Kottayam, and Kinder Women's Hospital, Cherthala. Her area of special interests are IUGR and multifetal pregnancy. I hand over the mic now to Dr. Anita Joseph. Ma'am, please go ahead.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for that introduction. It's a pleasure to be here among all of you. I'm sure Nagpur, I only know Dr. Ashish Kubde, and you have somebody as wonderful as him as part of your society. I can only imagine how dynamic the entire society must be. And it's indeed a pleasure to be part of this CME. Because preterm labor is something that is very close to my heart. When sir initially told me about this topic, let me just share my screen with you. Can you see my screen?
Yes, yes.
All right. So when sir first told me about this topic, prediction of preterm labor, it took me back a few years, and I immediately thought of a patient of mine. This was in the year 2010. I passed out, finished my post-graduation in 2007, and my husband was also a gynecologist. Both of us were practicing in one of the remote areas in Kerala, that is Kumuli, near Thekkady. And I had this primary gravida, a 24-year-old sweet girl, medical social worker, from a relatively well-off family, otherwise uncomplicated pregnancy. You know, she was the kind of person that you tend to like more than the other patients somehow, because she's such a sweet girl. And everything seemed fine, and we were not prepared for what happened at 26 weeks. That is, she came, she delivered at 26 weeks, a preterm baby girl of 700 grams. It was a very difficult, this was unexpected, and it was difficult to take because I had delivered this 6 months ago. I had delivered a healthy term baby girl. And I knew that, there were no risk factors in her, there were no risk factors in me. And I thought, oh, this could happen to anybody. Because I thought I had done everything well. I had done my best for her, and there was nothing more I could do. That was the only consolation at that time. Because that was the prevailing sentiment, that we did our best, and nothing much could have been done. A year later, I joined for my fetal medicine training. And in that FMU, we realized that every woman was being screened for preterm labor because they were offered transvaginal cervical length assessment. And it was only then that I realized that there was something that I did not do for her, for my patients in general. And that is what life is. We keep learning through the years. And I realized that training for preterm labor is as important as training for GBM, as important as training for Down syndrome, maybe more important, because all the speakers before me mentioned that preterm labor is a big burden. That I don't have to highlight that prematurity is a huge killer. And if there was a way in which we could predict and prevent preterm labor, we should certainly try our best. I don't need to explain this slide anymore. This has already been discussed. Now, the burden is not just on the doctors and the parents, it's also on the country as well, especially if the state is taking care of the neonate. It's a huge financial burden, it's a huge psychological burden, and a physical burden for many of them. But not all preterms are bad. We know that if the overall prevalence is, say, 4%, about 3% of them deliver after 34 weeks. And after 34 weeks is not a very bad time to deliver because the outcomes of this group is almost similar to that of term fetuses. As the gestational age advances, the morbidity and mortality comes down. So the morbidity and mortality has an inverse relationship to the gestational age at birth. So for all practical purposes, we are concerned about preterm labor that happens at less than 34 weeks. Okay? Not the late preterms, because they tend to have a relatively okay kind of outcome. Why does preterm labor happen? 2/3 of the preterm deliveries are spontaneous preterm labor, but in 1/3 of cases, these deliveries are medically indicated. The mothers are having preeclampsia, the fetus has got IUGR, there's been a placenta previa and abduction, or you suspect an infection. You feel like it's better for the baby to be out of the womb than within. You go in and induce a preterm delivery. But in 2/3 of the cases, it is spontaneous. That is, the uterus, the membranes, and the cervix do not cooperate into keeping the fetus inside the uterus until it's time. The myometrium is not quiet. It starts contracting early, which results in preterm labor. The cervix is incompetent, so that before term, it results in an expulsion of a fetus. Or there's a membrane, there's a problem with membrane integrity, and that is a premature rupture of membrane. And as doctors before me mentioned, there's no decline in the rate of preterm birth, not just in India, all over the world. In fact, it seems to be on the rise. So all this understanding that we have of preterm labor has not translated into any effective method of screening and prevention. Okay, and that is the fact of the matter. Why is it so? Why haven't we performed well in this area? It's because it's such a complex etiology. If you compare it to Down syndrome screening, Down syndrome is one entity. You have extra genetic material from chromosome 21. And you need one test to diagnose it, that is amniocentesis. And you have good effective screening measures before that, a combined test, and now even NIPT. But preterm labor isn't like that. You have an immunity of maternal uterine, fetal factors, and it's difficult to find one test which can predict it, and it's difficult to find one single intervention that can prevent it. But let's give it a try, okay? We are going to try and look at strategies for screening. At the outset, I would like to say that we haven't hit the perfect test yet. But there are a few strategies that might help us. And that is what I'm going to discuss today. Traditionally, what was done, and what I had done earlier was a history-based theory. When a woman walks in, you're very good at history dating. We look at all the possible risk factors that can be there for preterm labor. And if something shoots up in our history, then we treat it as high risk. All right, infections and if there's a history of second little uterine anomaly, previous preterm birth, all these things can be an indicator that this woman is at increased risk for preterm labor. Now, of all the pointers in history, probably the most important one is a previous preterm birth. And there are many societies that still say that this is the only way you can, you have to screen for preterm labor, including the guidelines in UK and USA. They advocate screening based on previous obstetric history or other risk factors that are found during your history date. The problem is that if you look at the spontaneous preterm birth less than 34 weeks, only 15% of them are going to have a previous history of preterm birth, which means that in about 85% of women who deliver before 34 weeks spontaneously, they would either be nulliparous or would have had a previous term delivery. So just using history to isolate the cohort of women who are at an increased risk for preterm labor would not serve as well, as it happened in the case that I discussed before. What we need to do is we need to offer universal screening for preterm labor. Okay, and let's see what can be done about it. I mentioned earlier that the perfect screening tool is elusive. Your history taking can serve give you the background risk. You know that this patient is in higher risk or low risk, but that risk can be modified further if you add on a few things, just like you do in Down syndrome screening. In Down syndrome screening, you have a maternal age-based risk, and then we add NC, nasal bone, we add biochemical markers, and then we try to get a combined risk, which is better than the risk assessment based on history alone, or maternal age alone. It's a similar kind of policy which is advocated in screening for preterm labor, where they say that you take a history, but then you try to add on a few more factors so that the performance of the screening test becomes better. In the UK, fetal fibronectin is quite popular. Now, fetal fibronectin is a glue that is, attaches the membranes to the decidua. And after 22 weeks, this should be found in a negligible amount in the cervical vaginal secretion. If you find a higher level of FSM, you know that somehow this glue is not working very well and that the fetus is, there's a risk that the fetus would deliver prematurely. In India, it's not very prevalent. And what we basically depend upon is history and measurement of the cervical length. So for all practical purposes, that is the screening method that I'm going to be talking about. Look at history, including history of previous preterm birth, and try to do an assessment of the cervical length. Now, cervical length assessment, they have given a cutoff for short cervix, and that is 25 millimeters. So why is this? So in this large study, when they compared the cervical length of women who delivered at term and of those who delivered prematurely, that is at less than 34 weeks, they found a difference. And the difference they found is that the women who delivered preterm are denoted by this blue line, and those who delivered a term are denoted by this purple line. And you see that women who delivered preterm, that is the blue line, they significant number of them had a shorter cervical length of 25. So that means 10% of the population would have a cervical length of less than 25 millimeter. And in that category, you would be able to detect about 40% of women who would go on to deliver at less than 34 weeks. This is how they found the cutoff of 25. If you take a lower cutoff, then the positivity rate, fewer patients are going to be selected, but the detection rate also comes down. It's reasonable to take a cutoff of 25 millimeters. So I'm going to, whenever I see short cervix, I would be testing to a cervical length of 25 millimeters. Now, not all short cervices are problematic. No, we know that. Because a short cervix can just be a normal variant, there may not be any tissue remodeling, and the woman may not be predisposed to a preterm delivery. But in quite a few cases, there would be abnormal extracellular matrix remodeling, and that would result in preterm birth. And sometimes it's not the problem of the length of cervix, it's that the internal organ, the sphincter complex is deficient or doesn't work well. It's a case of cervical incompetence. And in these women, you may not have a short cervix. Please don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that only if there's a short cervix, you have a problem. And if it's a short cervix, definitely a problem. No. I'm not saying that. It's just like NT. An NT of 3 can be normal, and you can have a downgrade even at an NT of 1.7 millimeter. It's just short service is just a marker that will help us identify more women who are at risk for preterm labor. Let me take you to some of the technical aspects of measurement of cervical length, because this is important. Like an NT scan, who does the NT scan matter? No, anybody can give you any measurement, but if the measurement is not reliable, then your management would not be, how do you say, effective. So let's look at the technical aspects. One question we ask is, when do we take a cervical length measurement? We do not necessarily have to call the patient in just to measure the cervical length. What we do is we do it routinely while we're performing the maternity anomaly scan. That is 18 to 22 weeks. Whenever you're doing a maternity anomaly scan, we also look at the cervical length. We do it earlier if there's some significant history. If this woman has delivered early, a preterm baby earlier, or there has been a surgery on the cervix. In those cases, it's pragmatic. It makes sense to call them earlier, right? And take a look at the cervix at 16 to 18 weeks. We do it even at 12 weeks. The international guidelines don't really recommend that. We do it at 12 weeks because we anyway do a transvaginal assessment during NT scan. So we start following the patients at 12 weeks. But if you're not doing that, I think it's okay. You can still aim to look at the cervical length at 20 weeks when, along with the anomaly scan. How do we do it? And these are the FMS guidelines, okay? Foundation for Preterm Medicine, UK, that is the foundation by Nicolaitis. They have laid down very strict guidelines, and this helps us because it helps us standardize our measurements. Now, it has to be a transvaginal assessment, not a transabdominal assessment. Let me tell you why. This is a transabdominal scan of the cervix, and you see that you really can't make out where the cervix is. Pardon? Okay, I think all right, let me continue. So here you don't see the lower end of the cervix very well. But in the same patient, if I do a transvaginal scan, I can see the cervix beautifully. So this is why transvaginal assessment is what is recommended. You need to prep for a transvaginal scan, which means you have to empty the bladder. There should be a toilet facility in the building, but that is something that the PLDT Act anyway specifies for us. We need to insert the probe into the anterior fornix without any undue pressure, because if you put a lot of pressure on the cervix, there's a false lengthening of the cervix. And in the cervical view, we need to identify the internal and the external orb using the endocervical mucosa as the guide. And the linear distance is measured between the internal orb and the external orb. We take some time to do this, 2 or 3 minutes, take 2 or 3 measurements, and use the shortest measurement. This is a video of how we do the assessment. Transvaginal ultrasound is, and the cervix pops up beautifully. The endocervical mucosa here is hypoechoic, this part. It need not be hypoechoic always, it should be ultraechoic or even hyperechoic. But then you look at, this is the external orb, and this is somewhere here is where the endocervical mucosa is. You take a measurement sample here in a straight line. Now there are some technical aspects to it. There's a technique and learning, but I should say that this is not as difficult as being an NT scan. In order to get an NT scan right, you need about 100 examinations. But for a cervical assessment, if you do, you need somebody to supervise you, especially if you've not done any transvaginal scan. It takes on an average up to 23 scans for you to become relatively okay at doing a cervical length assessment, which is not a very large number. Okay, so the initial thing is you need to do it with about 18 with supervisor's help, and later you can do your own. This is how a normal long lengthy cervix looks like. It's a bit curved. Okay, sometimes you have very long cervices. You have this measurement of 5.9 millimeters. Now, this is an error because this is actually the lower segment of the uterus. And when there's a contraction, that part can look really, it can really elongate the, apparently it might seem that the cervix is long. It's somewhere here that the cervix ends. So this is why you need a little bit of training. And if you look at the measurements, some measurements, cervix, if you don't know to take the measurement properly, you might give it a long cervix. A short cervix is usually straight, right? And then you can also see funneling. A long cervix with a little bit of funneling is not important. It's always the residual cervical length that is important. So this provides the length of what you have to measure and incorporate in your screening protocol. Now, this is very easy to do. I think for obstetricians, it's not a big deal to do a transvaginal ultrasound. But there has been a lot of resistance from many people regarding doing routine transvaginal ultrasound among low-risk women. I actually wanted to look at my own data, but I do not have the time for it. But I did find a good study which was published in the AGOG and in 2016, where they looked at a historical cohort before they started implementing cervical length screening. And then they had their own study population of around 17,000. And they found that it is effective in screening and preventing preterm labor. Okay. The p-values are pretty good. And the number needed to screen, that means if you screen about 143 women, you'll pick up one short film. And if you start treating them, you need to treat about 11 of them in order to prevent one preterm birth. Now, this is a reasonable number compared to other conditions like preeclampsia or even Down syndrome. Now, see, women actually do not mind this, especially if you explain it to them why you're doing it. Now, this data is from the fetal clinic, which is in Pondicherry, and Dr. Manikandan, who is my senior from JISMA, he does excellent work in this field and in fetal medicine in general. And he gave us this data. This was their study on 5,400 women who underwent screening for, who came to his clinic in between 2017 and 2019, July. And what they found is that 96% of the women did not have any problem with transvaginal ultrasound. Among those 4% who did not accept it, then he explained why it was important. 2% did accept it, and there were 2% who still did not want it. So overall, the acceptance rate is around 98%, which is it's a thumbs up from the women. The reluctance is more from doctors. I think if it's the radiologist who's doing a scan, they are very uncomfortable with the pathway and the ultrasound. But for us gynecologists, I think it should not be a problem. This is something which can be implemented. We're not asking for a test like a fetal fibrinogen, which adds to the cost. It just takes an extra 2 or 3 minutes of our time in order to do a cervical length assessment. Now, whatever we do, how does it translate into clinical management? How does that help us dealing with different clinical scenarios? And I'll just take a few minutes to talk about this. Let's look at the history, which is a history of previous preterm birth. I would call them earlier, 15 to 18 weeks, and start monitoring the cervical length. And if the cervical length goes below to 25 millimeters, we give them the option of progesterone or surplus. This is what is recommended, but then very often, you start progesterone. You won't wait for a short service of 25. Start progesterone earlier. You start progesterone earlier, and then if the cervical length still goes below,
Dr. Anita, kindly unmute yourself.
I think, yeah. All right. Can you hear me now? Yeah. What I was saying is that when the cervical length is less than 25 millimeter, then definitely we have to push for progesterone or surplus. Both work well in this situation, where there's a previous history of preterm birth. It will depend on the obstetrician's preference and, of course, the patient's preference. This is the most significant, the number of patients that we see is a short cervix detected during routine screening. There's no history, no risk factors, but we see a cervix length of less than 25 millimeters. And vaginal micronized progesterone has been studied extensively in this category, and it was found that there's a decrease in the preterm birth less than 32 weeks to about 45%. And it's most effective when the cervical length is shorter. And if you take a cutoff of 10 to 20 millimeters, you need to treat 7 people in order to prevent one preterm birth. And, but if there are features which are suggestive of cervical incompetence, then you have to understand the pathophysiology is completely different. In those cases, I think it's best to just offer them surplus. Elective surplus, and generally immediately after the NT scan, and the rescue surplus added on whenever needed. In multiple pregnancy, now this is an area of much debate and confusion, but there's recent data which has emerged that monitoring or screening for preterm labor by using cervical length measurement during the anomaly scan can help even in multiple pregnancy, and vaginal progesterone also helps in this category. Twins will always have a higher risk of delivery, like even for a cervical length of 3, where there's not much of a risk in singleton, twins are at a higher risk. Right? But even in these women, vaginal myosinized progesterone in those with cervical length of 25 millimeters is found to be beneficial. And what the good news is, we can prevent quite a lot of neonatal deaths per year if you spend a few minutes extra at each target cell. That is all that is required when you use cervical length for the screening modality. We can't prevent all, and that is another message that I want to get that across, because sometimes we get disheartened at all that we do. There's still some patients who deliver, and you know, after screening strategy doesn't pick everyone up, every case up, and that's okay. That's the best we can do. That brings me towards the end of my talk. I'd like to conclude by saying that prematurity is a significant burden, and if you start screening and preventing preterm labor, then the impact is significant, very significant. The current best screening tool is cervical length. It's not the perfect tool. It's not the answer to all your problems, but it is a pragmatic one. It is an efficacious one in that it prevents about 40 to 45% of preterm delivery. Acceptance is universal among the patients, at least. Doctors, at least in the UK and US, are still fighting it. Universal screening and action reduces the rate of spontaneous preterm birth. I would like to acknowledge a few people and institutions. One is the FMF UK, because Professor Nicolaides has been instrumental in getting a lot of screening strategies in place. And much of the material that I shared here is from his website. And also Dr. Manikandan, who I referred to earlier, my senior in Puducherry. He's been kind enough to share his data and slides with me. I have also looked at the NICE guidelines and the FOXI guidelines. Before I end, this is the Fetal Medicine UK website page. And you see that here you have calculators, risk assessment for preeclampsia, rising gestational diabetes, so on and so forth. And you also have a calculator for preterm birth. Okay, based on history and virgin survival length. This is pretty easy to navigate. You just put in the characters, maternal characteristics, tick those boxes where, you know, wherever it's required, and then press it, calculate this tab. You'll get a risk assessment. For instance, here, there was a patient with the previous preterm delivery at 34 to 36 weeks. He has now a cervical length of 25. And if you calculate the risk would differ if it is at 16 weeks, if the patient has had a previous preterm birth earlier, or it has been the patient has been a malnourished patient. So you can alter the maternal characteristics and calculate the risk from the various risks. These are very cumbersome to do, but these are available. And there's also something called the FIP app. Again, this is not something that we routinely use, but for those who are really interested and who want to know more, I would suggest that you go to the Fetal Medicine website, and where the course has been designed in such a way that's very easy to follow and understand, and really helps us in training ourselves, in equipping ourselves with how to take a survival measurement, how to interpret the data, and how to intervene. See, that brings me to the end of my talk. I'm very thankful for your patience listening. Thank you.
Sadhana, please conclude.
Sadhana ma'am, kindly unmute yourself, please.
Yeah.
Ma'am, you're still muted.
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you, madam, for such wonderful presentation. As you correctly said, prediction of preterm labor is the most important thing to prevent preterm labor. So as you so detailed for transvaginal cervical length examination, the discussion was so great for all practical tips. But I would like to say one thing, that one per vaginal examination at this stage in doubtful patients, that is those who are complaining of some heaviness or some cramping in lower abdomen or with some history of loose motions or such, some doubtful patients, if we do per vaginal examination at this stage, that also helps to predict preterm labor, because in addition to transvaginal cervical length, the consistency of cervix, that is the firmness of the cervix, whether it is patulous, all these factors also which we see clinically are important in prediction of preterm labor. So thank you for a wonderful presentation. Now I call upon Dr. Neeta Acharya. She is head of department, Datta Megate, Deemed University of Wardha. She is undergraduate teacher for 20 years and postgraduate teacher for 15 years. She has been trained in basic and advanced course in medical education and advanced infertility management and gynecological endoscopy. She is presently head of department, Datta Meghe University. She is ex-postgraduate convener for Jawaharlal Nehru Medical College. She has been past president and secretary of DCOGS affiliated to FOCSI. And she is secretary of Silver Jubilee Committee of JNMC. She has on her record almost more than 25 scientific publications and awards in form of Korean Young Research Award, Amox Mumbai, and Wonder Foxian Award, 2019. I call upon Dr. Acharya Mann for further presentation of role of progesterone in preterm labor.
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, ma'am.
Good afternoon to the entire team of NOGS. And at the outset, let me thank Dr. Alka Mukherjee and Dr. Ashish Kubre, sir, my teacher, for giving me this opportunity and all the dignitaries present today. The previous speaker has already given in detail about prediction of preterm labor. And she has already put in her slide that how progesterone is helpful in management of such high-risk pregnancies. What I'm going to present here, because most of us are either using progesterone or we know that progesterone is very useful in preventing this preterm labor in certain population. What I'm going to present here is just the evidence which is either proving that how progesterone is important and how different routes, preparations which are available for use and what PIGO and the international bodies are recommending. Now let me just start. My presentation is visible, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So we all know that the preterm births are the main global burden because it leads to so much of wastage of feti, and 2% of infants born are almost at 32 weeks. Now more than 90% of those born are below. They all need to see these complications. I'm not going to go into details because we all are aware of it. Just a minute. Yeah. So we all know that the burden of preterm birth in India, among total 27 million babies born annually, 3.6 million babies are born preterm, and over 3 lakh of these babies, they die each year. India, with its highest number of preterm births and highest number of preterm deaths worldwide, continues to contribute to almost 25% of global burden. Now, previous preterm delivery is the strongest risk factors. Madam has already, the previous speaker has already elaborated about all the risk factors, and she has very nicely elaborated about the cervical length measurement, right? So after one preterm birth, one of the risk factors, we all know that if she has one preterm birth, the risk in the next pregnancy is 20%. And after two preterm deliveries, the risk goes almost to 40%. Now, is this prevention possible? Is progesterone a choice for this prevention? And if yes, what is the route and what is the dose and what is the preparation? That is the basic thing which I'm going to say, and it is all from the evidence which is available in the literature. Now, primary prevention, we all know, is by detecting the high-risk factors during antenatal care. And with that, we do the awareness health education for all these women. Secondary prevention, we all know that we try to detect it early by certain biomarkers, like we all know this fetal fibronectin and cervical length, which has been elaborated quite well. And also we rule out other causes, which we all know, like infections and all, which could be the precipitating factor for preterm labor. So just cervical length and these biomarkers may not be the cause for preterm labor. It's a multifactorial thing. Many a times you don't know why this patient is going into preterm labor. Now the incidental finding of short cervix. Now, say 10 years back, if you went 10 years back, the RCOG guideline was saying there is no need of any intervention for incidental finding of short cervix. Now, the evidence over the last 10 years, they have changed it that prophylactic progesterone is and should be used for such patients who have short cervix. Now, let me go to progesterone. We all know the molecular biology of progesterone, how from cholesterol to derivatives we go. This is basically I had made for postgraduate students because they all are also attending this webinar. Now, progesterone, we all know it's a progestation hormone. It is essential for pregnancy preparation, implantation, support, and continuation of pregnancy. It's also an immunomodulator. It induces the TH2 response, essential for normal pregnancy. It increases nitric oxide NO production, increases uterine blood flow and endothelial adaptation, and decreases contractility of myometrium. This is in general the role of progesterone we all know since our postgraduate days. Now, these are the different progesterone preparations which are available, out of which we all know the micronized progesterone, dihydrogesterone, progesterone gel, and 17-hydroxyprogesterone caprovate are basically used for pregnancy ailments. Now, how does it act? There are different theories which have been given. In humans, the progesterone receptor PR has two major subtypes, PRA and PRB. Binding of progesterone to PRA, the short form of the receptor, not thought to be associated with intracellular pathway mechanism, prevents the actions of progesterone mediated by PRB. An increase in the PRA to PRB expression ratio occurs at the onset of labor at term, resulting in an increase in myometrial PRA and in effect, a functional withdrawal of progesterone with increasing sensitivity to contractile stimuli. Now, prostaglandins produced prior to the onset of labor also act to increase the PRA to PRB expression ratio, therefore the potential to initiate the functional withdrawal of progesterone. Now, another theory says that it is in this context that the progesterone has an anti-inflammatory property, raising the possible link between inflammatory process, alteration in progesterone receptor expression, and onset of preterm labor. While it has been postulated that the effect of progesterone on preterm birth is related to its anti-inflammatory properties, the specific mechanism of action still remains unclear. The number of investigators have developed models of inflammation in pregnant animals and examined the effect of pre-treatment with progesterone on inflammatory mediators. So T helper 2 shift is another theory which they have put forward. Then progesterone induced blocking factor decreases the decidual natural killer cell activity. It increases the asymmetrical antibodies, masks fecal antigens. How does it act at different levels on the uterus? So on cervix, it decreases the cervical stromal degradation, barrier to ascending infection, inhibits cervical ripening, and improves cervical length in short cervix. So this is all evidence-based, which I have collected from the different studies. Then myometrium, it decreases the myometrial oxytocin receptors and decreases contraction frequency. And decidua attenuates response to hemorrhage and inflammation. Basically, it acts on fecal membranes, placenta, suppresses prostaglandin synthesis, and decreases apoptosis. So this is a diagram which the students can draw for their exams. So for this was made for basically for postgraduate students. Now, there are two types of progesterone therapy currently used for preterm labor. Either a weekly intramuscular injection of 17-alpha-hydroxyprogesterone caprovate and daily administration of either one of these, that is either natural micronized progesterone, vaginal gel, vaginal suppository, or oral capsules. Now, what are the pros and cons of all these preparations? We all know that oral has the easiest way to administer, can be taken anywhere, better acceptable and tolerable to women. Then the vaginal one has higher uterine concentration, needs privacy, but and 10% may have vaginal dryness and irritability. And but the last one is intramuscular, though it can be given just weekly. It reaches optimum blood level, but it is extremely painful, needs to be given by a paramedic. Then abscess formation is a risk factor. Now, these are a few other points which I got. Oral, it is variable absorption and undergoes first pass metabolism. Bioavailability is uncertain and higher risk of CNS sedation. Vaginally, high endometrial concentration is achieved, but difficult to achieve constant blood levels. Intramuscular, it is slow release. Optimal blood levels are reached better than the other ones. These are the different progesterones which are used, and whatever clinical trials have been, I'll be quoting later on, they have used these preparations. So 17 hydroxyprogesterone caproate available as intramuscular injection, 250 milligram is the dose available. It is given weekly. Few studies have used 500 milligram. Natural micronized progesterone, vaginal suppositories available as 100, 200, 400 microgram has to be used daily. The gel is available as 80 or 90 milligram, has to be used daily. And oral capsule, we all know, again, same daily doses to be given. Now, 17 alpha hydroxyprogesterone caproate, it's a synthetic derivative of progesterone. It is inactivated when taken orally. Thus, it has to be injected intramuscularly. The half-life of it is 7 to 7.8 days. Therefore, it is usually administered once a week to maintain serum concentration. Weekly intramuscular injection of 250 milligram was effective in preventing preterm birth in pregnant women with history of preterm birth. Then vaginal progesterone delivers where it is needed. There is first uterine pass effect is there, and direct diffusion within 6 hours of administration, counter current exchange, concentration in uterus is very high. Vaginal gel 8% in polycarbophil base, special applicator is there, easy to use with no wastage of drug. Excellent vaginal moisturizing property is also there. This is the added benefit. Now vaginal progesterone gel is administered through a specific applicator and the dose is 90 milligram. And it was used, whatever studies I'll be quoting ahead, they have used 90 milligram as a dose of gel. The vaginal progesterone suppository is inserted in the vagina with clean hands or plastic gloves. The patient has to be trained about it and explained how to put it. The suppository is placed in the vaginal opening first and then pushed approximately 2 inches inside every day before bedtime. And a dose of 100 milligram was used in trials that targeted pregnant women with history of preterm birth or who had those high risk factors, like what Adam said, the short cervix on ultrasound examination in the early second trimester. Now, vaginal progesterones, the studies have shown that they have direct diffusion. This was, I think, already explained. Then oral progesterones, we all know that they are available as natural micronized progesterones and dihydrogesterone. All the clinical trials which are available, they basically are done on natural micronized progesterones. Recently, there have been few studies who have studied duphastrone or dihydrogesterone for its effect on the prevention of preterm labor, but the studies are not as strong. It is not still recommended by the international bodies for prevention of preterm labor in their guidelines. So micronization in the micronized progesterone reduces particle size, increases surface area of the drug, enhances aqueous dissolution rate, enhances intestinal absorption. Side effects of synthetic progesterones can be minimized or eliminated through the use of natural progesterone. Dihydrogesterone, as I said, it's the treatment of women at risk of preterm delivery results in increased production and interleukin-10 concentrations and lower concentration of interferon NY and gamma, and could be effective for prevention or treatment of preterm labor. Further randomized studies are still needed. There are a few studies available, or the clinical trials are available, where they have said that dihydrogesterone is effective with the dose of 10 milligrams thrice a day for prevention of preterm labor, but the international bodies are still not recommending it in their guidelines. Now, these are different clinical trials which we got from the PubMed search. So these are the basic major trials which examined. So Mies et al., they studied the intramuscular 17 alpha hydroxyprogesterone acetate versus placebo for prevention of preterm labor. All these studies, I found that they had done same cervical length screening, or they had a high risk factor, and they had chosen this population. And most of them, you will find that the prevention is much achieved quite well when they have used some kind of progesterone in these studies. So there are studies which have used vaginal suppositories, and the preterm rates in their study group is much less than what you see in the placebo group. So the different studies here quoted have used 17 alpha hydroxyprogesterone. Some has the Fonseca, they have used vaginal suppository. So all of them have used, and definitely progesterone helps in reducing the percentage or incidence of preterm labor when it is compared with placebo. Now coming to these studies, few more studies which have used them for singleton and twin also pregnancies, and they have found that the preterm labor incidence is much less when progesterone is used in such population also. Because we all are worried about our IVF pregnancies, and many of them may be having multiple pregnancies. So is progesterone helpful in preventing? So these were the few studies. The BJOG has recommended that only vaginal progesterone is effective. So no other route they are recommending. Then there was a higher rate of maternal adverse effects in the oral progesterone route that included dizziness when it was compared with the vaginal route. So they recommend that vaginal route is much better than the oral route, though oral route appears to be easier for administration, but the side effects are less if it is used vaginally. And as we all know, the concentration is going to be highest, and where it is needed, it reaches very well. So further randomized study on oral progesterone compared with other established therapies they have recommended. This was a study done in 2019. They have published it by Boeing, RC et al. So vaginal progesterone was the only intervention with consistent effectiveness for preventing preterm birth in singleton at-risk pregnancies overall, and in those with previous preterm birth. This was a systematic review of almost 40 trials they have verified and they have analyzed. And this is the population, just see the population, and it has been proved without any doubt that vaginal route is much better than the other routes. Then coming to progesterone to prevent preterm birth in twins. Overall twin pregnancy rate and twin pregnancies with short cervix, they had, the population was like that, and no significant difference in reducing the delivery below 34 weeks was found. So the data is not still, the evidence is not very strong in cases of twin pregnancies. Few studies are recommending it, few studies are saying it, they are not going to prevent totally just with the so comparing prevention in unselected.
Ma'am, kindly
please mute yourself.
Am I audible?
Yeah,
yes, ma'am.
You are.
You are, ma'am.
Yeah. Just a minute. So these are few studies which I had taken just to compare the different routes and which route is better. We all already know that the vaginal route is preferred mode of delivery, but then the evidence also proves that how effective it is compared to other modalities. Now, is progesterone safe? Maternal adverse events, congenital anomalies, and adverse neurodevelopmental and health outcomes at 2 years of age did not differ when progesterone was used as a preventive method. No significant beneficial or harmful effects on primary obstetric, neonatal, or childhood outcomes were seen in these recent studies. Now, safety, another points, other studies. Vaginal progesterone for preventing preterm birth and adverse perinatal outcomes in singleton gestations with short cervix. It was a meta-analysis done, and it was done in 2018. It was published in American Journal. They concluded that vaginal progesterone decreases the risk of preterm birth and improves perinatal outcomes in singleton gestations with mid-trimester sonographic short cervix, as Madam has already demonstrated quite well, without any demonstrable deleterious effects on childhood neurodevelopment. Other meta-analysis showed that administration of vaginal progesterone to asymptomatic women with a twin gestation and sonographic short cervix in the mid-trimester reduces the risk of preterm birth occurring at 30 to 35, less than 35 gestational age. And neonatal mortality is also reduced. So this was published in 2017. Now, the effectiveness of reducing the incidence of preterm birth in IVF ICSI twins using natural progesterone starting from first trimester. This is an ongoing research which is, you know, which is going on, which I found that the clinical trials are in vogue on this topic, and the conclusions have still not come completely. and at least Cochrane has not given at least meta-analysis on this topic as yet. So safety-wise, regarding significant pregnancies, only two studies have examined the long-term effect of progesterones. The follow-up study of 17-hydroxyprogesterone caproate by Misetal showed no difference in any of the developmental domains of children assessed at 2 years, with approximately 80% available for assessment. A childhood developmental assessment was one of the three primary outcomes in the study, which showed no difference in cognitive composite score between the active and placebo groups. There was a trend towards higher moderate to severe neurodevelopmental disability in the progesterone group as compared with the placebo group. Now, the most recent Cochrane review on progesterone for the prevention of preterm birth examined the evidence of use of any progesterone for women at risk of preterm birth, either because of previous preterm birth or because of short cervix. Although the two risk categories were examined separately, all progesterones were considered together. For women with previous preterm birth, the review suggested that progesterones reduce the risk of preterm birth before 34 weeks of gestation. Dihydrogestrone, we all are familiar, duphastone. The use of dihydrogestrone 2 into 20 milligrams given per orally appears to achieve preterm labor and preterm birth prevention when used from 16th week of gestation until 37 weeks of gestation. This was shown for a history of previous preterm birth or a short cervix. Treatment of preterm labor without rupture of amniotic membranes can be accomplished by giving it 20 milligrams twice a day daily with or without topolytic drugs. But the, you know, as I already said, the international bodies are still not recommending dihydrogestrone for prevention of preterm, but there are clinical trials who have examined the role of dihydrogestrone. Now, what FIGO is recommending? In 2015, the international working group by FIGO recommends following guidelines. The sonographic cervical length measurement should be performed in all pregnant women at this gestation, 19 to 23 weeks, using TVS. This can be done at the same time as the ultrasound performed for the anatomical survey. As Madam has rightly pointed out in the previous lecture, they recommend following guidelines. So women with sonographic short cervix, less than 25 millimeter, diagnosed in the mid-trimester, should be offered daily vaginal micronized progesterone treatment for the prevention of preterm birth and neonatal morbidity. The progesterone formulation to be used in vaginal micronized progesterone, that is 200 microgram milligram vaginal soft capsules nightly, or vaginal gel, that is 90 milligram each morning. So they have specified the timings also. Universal cervical length screening and vaginal progesterone treatment, that is 90 milligram vaginal gel or 200 milligram micronized vaginal soft capsules, is a cost-effective model for prevention of preterm birth. In cases in which a transvaginal sonography is not available, other devices may be used as a screening tool to measure objectively or reliably as the cervical length. As Madam had said that clinically also, if we feel that the cervix is short, then we can start the progesterone therapy. Now, these are different international bodies which are quoted here. The National Institute of Clinical Excellence in United Kingdom, FIGO, and Society for Fetomaternal Medicine. The Society for Fetomaternal Medicine, they recommend 17-hydroxyprogesterone caproate intramuscularly weekly, starting at 16 to 20 weeks until 36th week for prevention. Whereas FIGO and National Institute of Clinical Science, NICE, they recommend vaginal progesterone. This is what has been recommended in the international guidelines. So in summary, progesterone is safe. It is effective in prevention of preterm labor, especially for those with high risk factors, previous preterm labor, short cervix, because it is not the answer for every cause of preterm labor. We should be wise enough to rule out the other causes like infection and treat those. Patient already has high risk factor, you are going to treat it with pre-pregnancy itself, if it is a maternal factor, right? So the further research is needed on multiple pregnancies, that is what the Cochrane database says, and IVF pregnancies. And progesterone has several advantages over the cerclage. So cerclage is not the first choice for, as Madam had said, that if it is an incompetent OS, definitely cerclage is needed. But for a short cervix, previously, the obstetricians were going ahead with cerclage. they said that now progesterone is fair enough to use, it is fair enough to use progesterone for prevention. Vaginal progesterone is the preferred route than the other routes of administration. These are the different guidelines like given by Australia. So majority of them have used the 200 milligram vaginally only, or most of them, as you can see here. And only, as I said, the Society for Fetomaternal Medicine is recommending or is has given green signal for the hydroxyprogesterone caproate injections weekly. So most of them are recommending either gel or either micronized progesterone vaginally. And dihydrogesterone, though has few clinical trials, they are not being recommended still. So though can be used, they are not in their guidelines. So these were different guidelines which have been summarized in one slide. And these are my references for all my slides. And what I would like to end is with treatment without prevention is highly, it is not sustainable. So we all should try to prevent in whichever way we can do. And I think progesterone is a good choice, very simple method to prevent in such high risk population. Thank you so much once again. Thank you, chairpersons, for your and all the dignitaries present here for your great patient hearing. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for such a detailed talk. I'm sure we all are using progesterone in our daily practice to prevent preterm births, but now we have learned the scientific basis and it is, we know that it is evidence-based. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
The last topic in this session is on antenatal steroids. We know how important steroids are to reduce the mortality and morbidity in preterm babies. And to enlighten us in the nitty-gritties of antenatal steroid is the next speaker, Dr. Raju Giraddi. He is a consultant at Bettadur Hospital, Raichur, Karnataka. Over to you, Dr. Raju, for your deliberation. Dr. Raju?
Yes, ma'am. Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, you are audible. Please go ahead.
My screen is shared, right? Hello?
Yes.
Yes, sir. It is visible.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Namaste. Good evening to one and all. At the very onset, I would like to thank the prestigious Nagpur Obstetric Society and especially my beloved sir, Dr. Ashish Kubrasher, for giving me this great opportunity to speak on this great platform where I have almost my teachers there, and being one of the most youngest among the speakers in this August and eminent speakers, I consider it to be an honor. Thank you so much, sir, for giving me this opportunity to talk on antenatal corticosteroids, which is very close to my heart. The very first slide, you would be knowing that I have mentioned there are two circles here. This represents a logo of collaboration. I will come to that. What is that importance of this particular logo that I have mentioned it in my very first slide? As we all know that the burden of preterm is already being discussed with respect to the incidence and all. As we obstetricians at the present moment, we can act as at the base level that that the antenatal corticosteroids are among the low hanging fruit in the management of preterm labor and birth. Today, with respect to our webinar, I would like to take it in a different way with the understanding of antenatal corticosteroids. Definitely many would have come across various talks in webinars these days on antenatal corticosteroids. To actually do a very good homework, we obstetricians should, if you want to really know how these antenatal corticosteroids do help in managing the preterm labor and especially the birth and the complications that that are associated with the preterm, you should be looking into more of pediatric or neonatology textbooks and their webinars as well. But today, as an obstetrician, what exactly we can do? Are we doing justice in actually managing these cases? Are we giving the right dose? Are we giving the right... any problem, sir? Are we giving the right dose?
No.
Or are we giving the right molecule at the present moment? Or are we just making unorthodox, are we following unorthodox methods? So we'll try to touch upon those areas. So my basic objectives of today's topic will be, I would like to touch upon small brief history of it, mechanism of action, everybody will be knowing. So my main interest would be, whether are we giving the right salt in managing these cases? Are we following the right route of administration? And what is the rationale behind giving it as an IM route? And what is the importance of giving it as a cumulative dose of 24 milligrams, be it betamethasone or dexamethasone? And we'll touch upon the evidence base that we have today on the use of antenatal corticosteroids in different gestational age groups. And some points on the ongoing trials, definitely after 2017, where we are being giving, where we are getting almost new recommendations for the last every 5 years, we should also look into what are the few ongoing trials as though. This slide, definitely, this has been touched upon by both the speakers, the problem what the antenatal, the preterm babies would have been having, the burden of preterm babies. And one of the most complication what we encounter is the severity of respiratory distress syndrome. And definitely with this innovation of antenatal corticosteroids, this the main entity which has been causing mortality and morbidity in the preterms has reduced. And this has stood to be one of the greatest innovations in the medical research entity. So my tribute to this great gentleman who is from New Zealand, he is Mont Liggins. Everybody know him. And these photos of these two great gentlemen who have revolutionized the research methodology in obstetrics and neonatology. Now, the person here is Mont Liggins, along with this is Dr. Hovey. He is a pediatrician. And in their work on the corticosteroids proved worth with so many premature babies were saved from complications of prematurity. The trial that was conducted by these two gentlemen still today stands as an epitome of the well-designed clinical trial ahead of the standard trial of that period. Significantly, the first slide which I put, it was nothing but a Cochrane logo, which is endorsed by these people, that they have endorsed the logo. This is called the forest plot. There are two C's which are opposing each other, and the graph inside what you see is the forest graph. This, incidentally, the graph which they have endorsed is of the studies that were done on antenatal corticosteroids, and they're time tested, and it has always from the day when these people started their research, when they published in 1972, it almost took 20 years after the National Institute of Health endorsed and recommended, saying that antenatal corticosteroids are the beneficial and should be one of the most primary interventions that we can use in our modalities in these days treatment. So apart from that, we all know why antenatal corticosteroids are there. Definitely, we were all concerned about respiratory distress syndrome. But definitely, if you look at the other importance of antenatal corticosteroids, we have preventions of necrotizing enterocolitis to up to 55%, interventricular hemorrhage to more than 45%. So Cochrane database reviewed all these things. Definitely, antenatal corticosteroids play a very important role in preventing most of the complications. But only unanswered thing which is of concern for the neonatologist would be antenatal corticosteroids still today on their impact in chronic lung disease is inconclusive. Mechanism of action, almost everybody know. I will just brief touch upon it. The most important action is its increase in surfactant production, and there is an acceleration of type 1 and type 2 pneumocytes. The importance, if you look into this photo, you will be knowing.
Sir, will you please unmute yourself?
Okay. Can you hear me now? Yeah.
Yes, we can.
Now, there are various other uses of membrane stabilizing action, as well as inducing pulmonary beta receptors and regulating gene functions. So, yeah. there is any problem. So I want to share a very important slide here.
Sir, please unmute yourself.
Sir, there is some problem with the.
No, sir. You can talk. We can hear you.
I would like to share a very important slide here with respect to our pulmonary effects that has been given by the antenatal corticosteroids. Whether it could be a.
It is seen over here, sir.
Yeah. One is on cytostructural maturation as well, which is an irreversible one. Definitely, with the very first shot of antenatal corticosteroid, the irreversible actions that are seen in these are acceleration of type 1 and type 2 pneumocytes and increase in saccular and alveolar gas volumes. But this entity may be the factor for giving a repeat dose of corticosteroid. That is, these actions are dose dependent. So that is the reason why this may be a reason that even after 7 days, when you give a corticosteroid and if she has not delivered, maybe you have to repeat. So we'll come to this entity later, where I would like to touch upon. So next important thing I would like to discuss is the salts, the compounds that we are having. Definitely, these are the only two, because these are time-tested compounds. Though we think of other corticosteroids also, but they have not proven as beneficial as these two. And only difference between these two is that they differ by just a sulfide group. And the metamethasone molecule, which was used by Liggins by himself, has been one of best proven till date. Whereas dexamethasone was later proven, it was later taken up by two other co-workers, and it did show a very same results as what betamethasone gave. So, but for we Indians, this is not what we want. Definitely, I'm not here to make a differentiation between these two compounds. Why? Because we actually, before that, why to know why we are so, in, why these two compounds are important was because is these two compounds readily cross the placenta and they are less extensively metabolized by the placental beta hydroxynase. They are devoid of mineralocorticoid action and they both have weak immunosuppression and longer duration of action. But for us, we Indians, we know that for all purposes, we should stick to DEXA. The reason why is that I know many would have been using betamethasone till date, and even our textbooks are mentioning betamethasone. My small suggestion over here is that when we don't have a particular compound, when we don't have a particular compound in our country, I request many of the authors who are mentioning both beta and DEXA, they should only just mention about beta, but definitely they should try to endorse or enforce more upon the dexamethasone. The reason here is, in India, the compound salt, that is betamethasone and acetate, which should be together for these antenatal corticosteroid regimen, is not available. So the salt that is available in India is only betamethasone phosphate, and which is short acting, and because it requires more frequent administration to compare to the others. What are the other difference that we can have in beta and dexa is that this compound betamethasone was actually marketed as celastrozone, which is a compound molecule of both, and it requires a particular temperature for its storage and action, whereas dexamethasone is stable at our room temperature and definitely available in almost all centers, and it has been enlisted as one of the most important essential drug component list of the WHO. So if you look into the UN Commission, which has given its statement that in India, betamethasone acetate plus phosphate is not sold at all in some countries, including India. So my request would be, most important thing, that we have to definitely shift to dexamethasone in our country. So definitely my talk today will be not differentiating. I'll not try to differentiate these two molecules. Yeah, why not that? Now, if you look into the Indian government guidelines, they also have definitely told that it is only dexamethasone that has to be given. So betamethasone salt, the salt in India is betamethasone phosphate, which is short acting and requires more frequent administration, which is not recommended. So yes, we are now for only DEXA. So henceforth, my topic, which all irrespective of the dosage and the schedule that I'm going to mention, will be always with respect to DEXA only. So we'll touch upon what is the dose that we are giving? Are we giving it the right dose? And what is the rationale behind giving such dose? I would like to put upon this very good paper, which is written by Ballard, is one such person who has done very good studies on antenatal corticosteroids. And this paper on scientific basis on therapeutic regimens of antenatal corticosteroids stands very good and one of the best papers you can see, and you can get in details of how antenatal corticosteroids make their actions in our body. So why do you know why we are giving it as 24 milligrams in divided doses? And why they have made it as 6 milligrams, this is for Dexa definitely, 6 milligrams 12th hourly and four divided doses. 6 milligram 12th hourly is because of the half-life of dexamethasone, which is a bit shorter than that of beta. And why we are giving it as 24 milligrams is because this has been a time-tested regimen. Right from Ligon's methodology, he even endorsed using 24 milligrams as a cumulative dose, because at this dosage, it is 75 to 80% of the receptors are filled and provide near maximal induction of corticosteroid mediated response to fetal target tissues. So only this will tell us that if we are reducing the dosage or increasing the dosage, definitely we'll be having more adverse effects, as sometimes we'll fall short of the good effects that antenatal corticosteroid should be giving. So IM, and one more important point, as we know, it is most of us, we are giving it in third trimester. Definitely the woman would have been more fatter than by that time. The most important route is IM, and definitely it's only the time tested route is IM, and I try to give it in the anterolateral aspect of the thigh rather than on the buttocks. So why do you think that, what is the rationale behind IM route? What if I give IV when we already want to say that I have already accessed an IV line to the mother? Why cannot, because Dexa can be given an IV route, why we cannot give IV? So if you look into the literature, IV route, the clinical efficacy has not been well studied in human pregnancy. Most important point is that with the IV regimen, we see rapid peaks and troughs in the maternal as well as fetal corticosteroids concentrations, and there are erratic physiological changes. So because of less sustained fetal exposure to corticosteroid stimulation, and thus may not be as effective as intramuscular route. So if you look at the markets, what we have, we will be having an ampoule or a vial there, but each 1 ml will be making up to 4 mg, but we don't have something which is making up to 6 mg. Definitely, we may have to cut short, or we may have to use a vial. But what is the care we have to take is that additional risk of contamination or spread of infection, we have to take care, especially when we are using multivial doses. So 6 mg is what we have to follow. Don't increase the dose, or not even don't decrease the dose. Timing, we all know what is the importance of that. The maximum therapeutic benefits, we get it once the dosage schedule is completed, only after that, 24 hours after the last dosage to 7 days post completion. So what if the mother has not delivered? You have diagnosed that she will deliver, but she will not deliver. What if she delivers before the completion of the course? There are studies saying that even if you give the first shot, definitely the benefits will come. And if you look at the various studies, the very first shot, you can give decrease the mortality by 28%. The first dose should be given even if there is the ability to give the second dose is very unlikely. What if the pregnancy is continued and if it goes beyond 7 days after steroid exposure? It depends on the number of days that have been gone. Definitely there will be help, but incidence of respiratory distress syndrome fall back to the normal previous back, as what I've already mentioned in my previous slide, of inducing nature of the corticosteroids, definitely. After 7 days, so for us, what is more important with this, the second part of the slide is, we should be very good so that our clinical acumen and our investigations should be such that we should clearly make sure that whether she is going to deliver in the next 7 days or if she is not going to deliver in the next 7 days, better not to give it. So now we'll touch upon what all the various society guidelines are telling about the gestational ages and what we have to be giving. be it the ACOG or the RCOG, and then the Canadian group, the FIGO, the Liggins Institute from New Zealand, or the the Society of Phytomedical Medicine. I will just try to compile upon what they have telling. Yes, antenatal corticosteroids have the best benefits to the preterm babies between 24 to 34 weeks of gestation. All society guidelines have recommended this. This is everybody knows. But the discussion should be whether what is the importance if we give it prior to 24 weeks or more than 34 weeks. Prior to 24 weeks, the 22 to 24 weeks is a gray area. Definitely maybe in very tertiary neonatal centers where the family members insist upon knowing the pros and cons of going for it, they can go for it. And antenatal corticosteroids, few randomized controlled trials are there saying that they can help it. But what about prior to 22 weeks? Why do antenatal corticosteroids do help? No, because there are only few primitive alveoli at this gestational age, which the drug can exert its effect or no effect can be seen. So prior to 22 weeks is where the benefits may not be seen. So most important area to be considered today for today's topic would be between the age groups of 34 to 36 plus 6 weeks of gestation. So many recommendations are coming these days. This was actually a gray area till 2017, only when a landmark paper came in 2016, antenatal betamethasone in late preterm, that ALPS trial. Based on this trial, many societies have started recommending, saying that yes, you can give one dose or you can give one antenatal corticosteroid regimen, especially the ACOG and the FIGO. The benefits that were seen, yes, definitely it reduced respiratory morbidity with significant lower rate of tachypnea of newborn. But there were increased incidence of neonatal hypoglycemia. But let me tell you, this study was done for betamethasone, not for DEXA. This rate of neonatal hypoglycemia is very transient, and definitely the relative risk was very low and very few admissions in NICU was required. But with respect to respiratory distress syndrome, there was no change. So guidelines for late preterm, ACOG and Society of Fetal Medicine, now they are recommending you can give a dose of corticosteroid in this age group. Important here is, provided that woman has not received a course of corticosteroid prior to 34 weeks of gestation, if you have not given a corticosteroid dose regimen, and if you think in this particular age, she is going to deliver in the next, she is in threatened preterm or preterm, and she's going to deliver in the next within 7 days, you can go for a schedule of antenatal corticosteroid. So to address this, we are looking out for this. For we developing countries like India and Southeast Asian nations, the WHO has taken up this trial, WHO Action Trial 2. It is in this age group of 34 weeks to 36 weeks, and particularly they are using the molecule here is dexamethasone. So we are waiting for this trial result, which is ongoing in Karnataka. In India, it is the Keli Hospital, which has been part of this group. We'll wait for the results to know what are the benefits and pros and cons. After this, the late preterm, that is between 37 to 39 weeks of gestation. Many studies have come, especially I want to stress upon this. Most of us are most of us are dealing with experience these days.
Sir, please unmute yourself.
Yeah.
Are you audible now?
Yes, ma'am. So it is only RCOG now, which is recommending giving antenatal corticosteroids prior to your cesarean deliveries prior to 39 weeks of gestation. Whereas other guidelines which are recommending, which have recommended, not all societies are recommending these. The routine use is not recommended prior to labor cesarean section by the Canadian group, whereas by the New Zealand Liggins Institute says it can be considered provided if fetal lung immaturity has been conferred. ACOG and NICE guidelines, they have not made any recommendation to date. The important trial which gave some disadvantageous results was the Aztecs trial. So there were significant decrease in NICU admission, the rate of non-respiratory morbidity was higher in this steroid group. And if you look into the later effects which are now coming up of corticosteroids given in the late preterm babies, we are all looking out for those, especially the learning abilities in the school kids. So these are all gray areas. More than 34 weeks to up to 39 weeks, we can still wait for some time to actually endorse ourselves saying that yes, routinely we can give. No, maybe we have to wait for some more time, for some more trials where they can give the results. So ongoing cesarean sections are more, and to understand this, the in New Zealand and Australia collaboration group, they have taken up the study, which is going to start this year, the corticosteroid trial group between 35 to 39 age groups, especially prior to cesarean sections, whether we should give routine corticosteroids or not. This trial may be ending up in 2024, and we will be waiting for this ongoing trial results, whether we should actually give it or not. So as I've already told you, benefits are maximum after 24 hours, but well within 7 days. So what one important thing I would like to stress upon, there is terminologies between rescue doses and repeat doses. Rescue doses is also called a salvage or booster dose. That is, you can give one course of antenatal corticosteroid therapy to a woman if she has received full prior course of antenatal corticosteroid at least 14 days or at least 1 week prior. Whereas repeat doses are those administering antenatal corticosteroid at regular intervals after giving one full corticosteroid. That is, it depends. Many people follow after every 15 days. Some people follow after every 1 week, which is actually not recommended. So if you look into the evidence of what repeat dosing has given the results, these two important trials, studies which gave us very, very much disadvantaging outcomes, especially with respect to decreased weight and head circumference at birth, was seen in both the trials, the ACCORD study and the MAC study. Whereas in school-going children, the attention disorder was more likely, and neurodevelopmental disability was more likely with the repeat dosing. So better stop giving repeated doses of antenatal corticosteroids. So for us, the woman stays with her with the observation that we should be very thorough in diagnosing a case of preterm. And we should give only in indicated cases. That is, a judicious use of antenatal corticosteroid should be there. So we'll touch upon some special populations. PPRM, as we all know, all guidelines have said, go for it, provided you have ruled out chorioamnionitis. Even with some studies have even coming up saying that chorioamnionitis even can be taken care of, and because the benefits of antenatal corticosteroids at these people with the extreme preterm, they outweigh the risk of that. In multiple pregnancies, though there are very few randomized control studies, but still the guidelines have endorsed saying that they recommend administering an antenatal corticosteroid with similar guidelines of a singleton pregnancy. Important entity we have to think is even whether we can give it in all diabetics. One important thing to understand is that there are no RCTs that have been done in diabetics. The reason is that women with diabetes generally have been excluded for the very reason we cannot give them complications of that. So prior hyperglycemia status of the mother before giving the antenatal corticosteroid is very important. You can titrate the dose of their insulin or whatever oral hyperglycemic drugs they might be taking. And on posted usage of these antenatal corticosteroids, you should look for incidence of hyperglycemia in them. So almost all societies have recommended in this category, but close monitoring and in these categories, especially you should be avoiding repeat courses. So in hypertension group, no problem at all, because these agents have very poor mineralocorticoid activity. Straight away go and give this antenatal corticosteroid, definitely of help. In IUGR as well as in SGA, for SGA, it stands same for any singleton. For IUGR, here an entity may be an intrauterine stress or already would have triggered the fetal adrenal cortisol maturity or release of glucocorticoids. But definitely in IUGR, you can consider giving one course, but not a repeat course. This topic, role of tocolytic in understanding antenatal corticosteroid, will be covered by the next speaker. But only one thing I would like to mention here: there is actually no role of continuing tocolytic in preventing preterm. The only role of tocolytic would be to transfer the mother or to take or buy some time to administer the antenatal corticosteroids. And especially after 34 weeks, most of the guidelines do not recommend giving tocolytics. So single dose, standard dose of antenatal corticosteroids, that is 24 milligram, what are the side effects you can think of? In fetal, very transient. In early neonatal period, benefits usually definitely they outweigh the risk. They're not significant as that. But in late preterm, you should be bothering that some studies have shown effects of neonatal hyperglycemia, but they're very transient. Whereas in maternal thing, hyperglycemia is again transient here. You can also have leukocytosis in the blood picture. But I have not added here repeated courses. Definitely repeated courses of antenatal corticosteroids have deleterious effects in both mother and baby. So I would with brief projection of antenatal corticosteroids and their usefulness, what we have in the present era, I would like to give you very short take-home messages. First and foremost, we will fix to DEXA only. Betamethasone, maybe we have to remove it from our textbooks also in Indian editions. This agent is not going to help us. And judicious use of antenatal corticosteroids is very must. Don't go for giving it as a routine for all cases. Antenatal corticosteroids, definitely they play a very important role, provided that you are giving it in the right time, right dosage, and the right time, right dosage, and the right gestational age. So do not try to alter the schedule that has been standardized, and they have all been time tested till date, and avoid repeated doses. And definitely with the ongoing trials that we have been seeing, though we can consider giving it as an age group between 34 to 36, 37 weeks of gestation, but it depends. Some more trials are definitely needed to understand these and to implement in our practice. Definitely antenatal corticosteroids remain as one of the most powerful tools in armamentarium to fight the complications of preterm. With this, I would like to end my talk, and thank you very much for giving me this great opportunity to highlight upon antenatal corticosteroids. Thank you.
Sadhana, please conclude. Sadhana madam, please unmute yourself. Sadhana madam, unmute yourself.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Raju, for such excellent presentation. It was very nice to have the difference between Indian betamethasone and the betamethasone available in other countries.
I'm kindly unmute yourself, please.
It was very nice to have the difference between betamethasone available in India and difference between betamethasone and dexamethasone. The point was very highly appreciated that we should give preference to dexamethasone. And secondly, the rescue dose is which is most important, and we should avoid giving repeated doses, as it has been proven that it gives neuromuscular coordination in newborns. So repeated doses has to be avoided. As we all of us know that steroids is a double-edged sword, it has to be used judiciously. And even if we are able to give a single dose, if within 5 to 6 hours of labor, if the patient goes in inevitable preterm labor, and even if we get 5 to 6 hours, then also it works. So in that case also the rescue dose would be important, but repeated doses have to be avoided. American society is still in favor of giving steroids only till 34 weeks. European societies are in favor of giving that gray zone from 34 to 36 weeks onwards. So I think in Indian countries where the management of preterm labor by babies is a more challenging job, we should give that advantage to our babies who are in that range of 35 to 36 weeks. So it was overall a very good, nice session of prediction of preterm labor, the management with progesterone, and role of antenatal corticosteroids. So we conclude this session, and thanks for all the wonderful speakers.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Sadhana, ma'am. Thank you, Sutapa, ma'am. Thank you, all the speakers. It was indeed an excellent session. Now we move on to our session two, and I request Dr. Manisha Sahu to please take over.
Thank you, Dr. Anjali. It is my proud privilege to welcome and introduce the chairpersons for the second session. But before that, let me announce that today CME has been granted one ICOG credit point. To avail this, please forward your name in with full MMC registration number to these following numbers. We acknowledge the academic support by MacLeod Pharmaceuticals, whose products are MacGist SR 200-300 mg and MacProt SR, which is the high-rich protein. The chairpersons for the second session are Dr. Shobha Gandhi, ma'am. Ma'am is a renowned senior obstetrician and gynecologic of Nagpur, practicing for the past more than 30 years. Ma'am is the past president.
Manisha, ma'am, kindly unmute yourself, please. Dr. Manisha, kindly unmute yourself.
It is my proud privilege to welcome and introduce the chairpersons for the second session. Our first chairperson is Dr. Shobha Gandhi, ma'am. Ma'am is a senior, renowned obstetrician and gynecologist of Nagpur, practicing for more than 30 years. Ma'am has been the past president of NOGS, director Gandhi Nursing Home and Cocoon Test Tube Baby Center. Presently, she is the project director of Rotary Club Nagpur East and also the project director of Adolescent Health Committee of NOGS. Ma'am is very active and has conducted various health checkup camps and various school projects. I welcome you, ma'am. Our second chairperson for this session is Dr. Anjali Bhandarkar, ma'am, who is a lady of grace and a great academician. She is a noted obstetrician and gynecologist of the city and a keen sonologist as well. I welcome Anjali, ma'am, and ma'am can kindly introduce the first stalwart in the making, Dr. Amo Chimote, and I hand over the further proceedings to Anjali, ma'am. Thank you.
Hello, am I audible, dear friends?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Welcome, dear friends, for the second session of CME dedicated to the management of preterm labor. After prediction of preterm labor and managing it with hormone and antenatal corticosteroid, what next? So comes the role of tocolytic agents. I invite Dr. Amok Chimote, young and dynamic gynecological endoscopy surgeon, obstetrician and gynecologist, and a fertility specialist. He is the winner of several quiz and paper presentation awards in various contexts. He is ESGE bachelor in gynecological endoscopy. He has diploma in gynecological endoscopy, CICE France, to his credit. He is a diplomat in obstetric gynecological ultrasonography, Ian Donald School. He has worked under Dr. Sang Par and as a fellow in gynec endoscopy. He has various publications to his credit in several national and international journals. And presently, he is executive committee member of Indian Fertility Society Vidarbha chapter and also Nagpur Obstetric Gynec Society for the year 2021-22. Presenting before you, Medical Director, Vanshadhara Fertility Center, Nagpur, Dr. Amok Chimote, to speak on the role of tocolytics in preterm labor.
Thank you so much, Anjali ma'am, for such a kind introduction. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Alka Mukherjee ma'am and Ashish Kubre sir, my mentor, for giving me this opportunity to talk between all these stalwarts. So preterm labor, it has been covered quite extensively, the causes and what are the preliminary things that can be done to prevent the labor, preterm labor. So I would be speaking on how to treat the preterm labor. Sorry for the technical glitch.
सुश्रुत हॉस्पिटल का कितना आ रहा है?
उनके पास से इंजेक्शन की एक बड़ी खेप 36 लाख रुपए नगद।
I hope I'm audible now.
Yes, Amog, you're audible.
So, tocolytics, as was mentioned by the previous speaker, is just a modality to buy time to save the baby as well as the mother. So, what do we know about preterm labor and tocolytics? So, this I think I would not be going through it. It has been covered extensively. So this is what exactly we see in a normal ANC patient. We have a smooth course, and this is what preterm labor does to a smooth ongoing pregnancy. And boom, out of nowhere, the patient lands up in preterm labor with a poor prognosis for the baby as well as the mother. So what do we expect the tocolytics to do and help us in preterm? Patient in preterm, the tocolytics just saved, and we all obstetricians are very, very happy that we have saved and salvaged the pregnancy. But to the contrary, what exactly do the tocolytics do? Have a view. Yes, dear friends, this is precisely what the preterm labor does and what tocolytics can do to prevent it. It tries its level hardest, but it is in vain. So what are the risks of preterm labor? I would not go into detail. We all, being a practicing obstetrician, know the risk of preterm labor. But what is important here is the maternal age. The higher the maternal age, the higher are the chances for a patient to go into preterm labor. So goals of use of the tocolytics are to just hold on to the contractions and give time for the steroids to act and salvage the baby or transport the mother to a higher tertiary center. So when can we use tocolytics? Tocolytics can be used when there is a diagnosed preterm labor. The gestational age at presentation is very important. What we generally follow is tocolytics can be started as early as 24 weeks, but should not be considered beyond 34 weeks. Thirdly, tocolytics can be used when there is a poor availability of neonatal care or a higher center available at where the mother is being treated. So what are the contraindications for tocolytics? So these are severe preeclampsia, placental abruption, chorioamnionitis, lethal congenital or chromosomal abnormalities diagnosed late or not diagnosed at all in the previous ultrasound, advanced cervical dilatation, fetal compromise or distress, and placental insufficiency. So what are the role of tocolytics? They are intended to arrest the uterine contraction during an episode of preterm labor.